गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर रॉय। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस वेजोमोटर राइनाइटिस। वी हैव प्रीवियसली डिस्कस्ड द टॉपिक ऑफ एलर्जिक राइनाइटिस एंड यू पीपल आर सपोज टू डिफरेंशिएट बिटवीन द टू कंडीशंस एज दे मोर और लेस ओवरलैप इन द क्लिनिकल प्रेजेंटेशन। द फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट थिंग टू बेयर इन माइंड इज दैट दिस राइनाइटिस इज नॉन एलर्जिक राइनाइटिस। बट द पॉइंट where one is confused between the two entities is the presentation, the clinical presentation with which the two entities present. They both can present with nasal allergy, that is with the symptoms of nasal obstruction, nasal discharge and sneezing. But an important thing to bear in mind is that this rhinitis, that is the vasomotor rhinitis, it persists throughout the year, and if you do the tests of nasal allergy, they all come out to be negative. You've seen this, that this is non-allergic rhinitis, and we have discussed this thing. Okay, before we embark upon the pathogenesis of vasomotor rhinitis, I would like you people to know that nasal mucosa is richly spread by blood vessels, and it is under the control of autonomic nervous system. I would like you people to walk down your memory lane and recall the effects of autonomic nervous system stimulation on blood vessels. I will reiterate for you, sympathetic stimulation causes vasoconstriction of the blood vessels that leads to shrinkage of the mucosa, whereas the parasympathetic stimulation causes vasodilatation and there is a resultant engorgement of the blood vessels. Regarding pathogenesis in vasomotor rhinitis, basically, the autonomic nervous system is unstable. So whenever there is a emotional instability, it can lead to symptoms of vasomotor rhinitis. To add on, the nasal mucosa is also hyperactive and responds to several non-specific stimuli, such as minor change in temperature, or if there are certain or if there are smaller amounts of dust or smoke, the patient starts having the symptoms of vasomotor rhinitis. So this is the pathophysiology that is related or that is causative in vasomotor rhinitis. Patient can present with any of the four symptoms, that is the paroxysmal sneezing, rhinorrhea, nasal obstruction and postnasal drip. But most likely he or she complains of bouts of sneezing the moment he or she gets out of the bed in the morning. Excessive rhinorrhea usually accompanies sneezing, or it can be the only predominant symptom, and in this case the nasal discharge is watery and is profuse in amount. It can also be associated with nasal obstruction that alternates from one side to the right to the other side and is more marked on the dependent side. Regarding the signs, if we examine the patient vasomotor rhinitis, we can appreciate that the nasal mucosa over the turbinates is congested and hypertrophic. You can visualize in this picture that the mucosa over the turbinates seems congested and is hypertrophic, but in some cases it can be normal. So in these cases it has to be a clinical diagnosis. The treatment always involves two arms, that is the medical treatment and the surgical treatment. But we always start from the medical treatment, and the most important aspect of the medical treatment is the avoidance of physical factors that provoke the symptoms. For example, if there is a sudden change in temperature or if there are exposure to dust or smoke, that have to be curtailed. In addition to this, we can make use of antihistaminics and oral nasal decongestants. They're helpful in relieving the symptoms of nasal obstruction, sneezing and rhinorrhea. If the symptoms are not controlled with antihistaminics and oral nasal decongestants, we can make use of topical steroids. Most commonly used topical steroids include beclomethasone or fluticasone. If all of these remedies appear to be insignificant or are unable to control the symptoms of vasomotor rhinitis, we can make use of systemic steroids, but they have to be given for a very short time in severe cases only. Otherwise, the systemic steroids are not used routinely in the treatment of vasomotor rhinitis. And lastly, but very important aspect is addressing the psychological factors which can cause vasomotor rhinitis, because we've already discussed that it is the instability of the autonomic nervous system that leads to vasomotor rhinitis. So these psychological factors, that is emotional disturbance, must be addressed in order to achieve remission or treatment of the medical of the vasomotor rhinitis. In treatment of vasomotor rhinitis, we can make use of tranquilizers that can help patient achieve relief from the symptoms of vasomotor rhinitis. But in case if their medical treatment fails, we have to jump to the surgical arm, that is the surgical treatment. In surgical treatment, we usually section the parasympathetic secretomotor fibers to the nose, and this procedure is called Wedian neurectomy. Apart from this, if there is any other source or cause of nasal obstruction, that must be relieved. As for example, we can reduce the size of the turbinates, or if there is associated deviated nasal septum, that should also be corrected and addressed. So this brings an end to our topic of vasomotor rhinitis. But before we end this, we have to discuss the complications that can be associated with the vasomotor rhinitis. In long-standing cases of vasomotor rhinitis, patients can develop nasal polyps, hypertrophic rhinitis, and sinusitis. You can see this. In this case, in this picture, the turbinates are enlarged. If you compare it with the above picture, turbinate appears to be normal, but in a patient who is having a long-standing vasomotor rhinitis, the turbinates can enlarge. So these are the complications that can happen with the vasomotor rhinitis. If you have any query about the topic, please feel free to contact me on the WhatsApp. Thank you very much.